Let's pick up talking about computing limits and using direct substitution and this other property called replacement for computing limits. So picking up right where we left off, how do we build up our bank of tools for computing limits? And that's what we're going to spend some time looking at in the next couple of examples, building up what we think of as like a tool bank, a bank of tools that we can use for computing limits. When I come across a limit of a function, what sort of tools can I use to do that? And this is a big one, this idea of replacement. And it was introduced in the last video, but let's pick up where we left off and do a couple more examples with this replacement. So the idea is if you have two functions that are equal, except possibly at a single point, x equals a, and the limit of g of x actually exists as x approaches a, then the two limits, the limit of the other function, the limit of f of x as x approaches of a, has to be the same as the limit of g of x as x approaches a. And what that does is it allows us to use some algebraic manipulations. So this was actually the example from the previous video. It's just typed up here, and I just wanted to start here as a little review. And so this is just the limit of a rational function, and it turns out that we can actually factor. So notice what's happening from here to here, we are factoring. So we're using that algebraic technique, and we're gonna do that a lot. We're gonna apply our algebraic technique here, and we're using factoring. Factoring is a great algebraic technique and gets used a lot to simplify expressions. So notice that we factor, we're able to cancel, and what ends up happening is that we have two functions. We end up with our original function, f of x, which was that original rational expression, x squared minus 7x plus 12 over x minus 3, and this new function, g of x, after we've simplified, that is just x minus 4. And these two functions are actually equivalent. These two functions are equal, except at that one point, x equals 3. So it's that one place where they're not equal. But because we can take the limit of this guy, the x minus 4, we can do that. We take the limit. Notice what we're doing here, just following this all the way through, follow the limit all the way through until we get to an answer for the limit of x minus 4. And then that means the limit of my original function has to be the same. And if we were to look at this, and I know I sketched this out by hand on the previous video, but if we were to just look at this, this is what the function g of x actually would have the whole filled in. This is the function f of x. F of x is simply the function g of x with a whole at that point 3. Okay? And that's what is allowing us to use that property. That's intuitively why that property works, because if there's a hole in the graph, that's not really what we're concerned with. We're concerned about the behavior around it when we're looking at a limit, not what happens right at x equals 3. Okay, so that's just a brief overview of where we're at coming into this video. And so let's pick up, and there is that other example from the last time, and let's pick up looking at several more examples in this video. So we're going to utilize two properties that were introduced previous to this, the direct substitution property that allows us just to directly substitute in if A is in the domain, and the second property that allows us to do what I just discussed, which is replace, use some algebraic simplification to do a replacement and calculate limits using replacements, replacement functions to calculate limits. Okay, so those are the two properties we're going to use. And in order to use that replacement property, we're going to apply some algebraic techniques. So let me just review over some of the algebraic techniques that you come into this class already having. So, you know, I jokingly say these are already in your toolbox. The computation part of these limits are things that you already know how to do. These are already in your, let's call it your math toolbox. Okay? These techniques I'm going to talk about are things you guys already know how to do. You just have to apply them in the context of limits, and that's what we're going to do here. So obviously the first one that we just discussed, one technique is factoring. So factoring expressions, expanding expressions, I'm going to put on the same line, because if you were to have a binomial squared or cubed or whatever, you could expand that. That's also an algebraic simplification technique. So factoring and expanding, utilizing when we have roots, utilizing multiplication by the conjugate. Okay. When we have fractions, so this is applicable when we have fractions. Let's bring that onto the same. Utilizing multiplying by the conjugate is applicable when we are working with fractions. Factoring and expanding is when we're working with polynomials. Okay, so those are kind of the types of functions or the types of expressions that would clue you into trying factoring or expanding. And then a third possibility, whenever we have fractions, combining fractions, whatever that might mean, adding them, multiplying, dividing, whatever we need to do, combining fractions or rational expressions. And I just realized I made a mistake. We don't want to multiply by the conjugate with fractions. Let's erase that. That doesn't make any sense. We want to utilize multiplying by the conjugate with roots. I think I said that, and then I was thinking ahead to my third option, and I wrote fractions, but I meant to write roots right there. Our third option, obviously, when we have fractions, we'll work with combining them. Okay, so those are some techniques that we already have in our toolboxes, our math toolboxes, trying to get this all on one page. In our math toolbox, those are some options we already have, some techniques that we already have for simplifying, and those are the ones that we're going to utilize. So let's look at a couple examples that do that. So here is, let's call this example one. So let's call this example one of utilizing some algebraic techniques. So if I come across a limit that looks like this, so the limit of the quantity 5 plus h cubed minus 125 over h as h goes to 0. So I want to just show you the whole thought process. The first thing I'm going to think about is that direct substitution. I'm going to think about doing a direct substitution of h equals 0 into this expression, and I'm going to see what happens. Notice what happens when I do that. When I plug in h equals 0, I get 5 cubed minus 125 over 0. And already we should start to see that we've got an issue. I'm going to highlight it in red here. We've got division by 0, which could mean a couple of things, but it definitely means we're not going to be able to evaluate the limit as it stands. We're going to have to think harder about it. Then I look at the numerator and I see that that becomes 125 minus 125 as well, which is also 0. And I end up with a 0 over 0, which for our purposes mathematically, that is interesting and means we need to do some more work. This just means you got to do some more work, because right now we can't evaluate this limit. This is what's actually considered what's called an indeterminate form, meaning we can't determine anything from that form, and we need to do some more work. So that's when I come back to the original expression and I think, how could I simplify this algebraically? And algebraically, when I see that rational expression, I think to myself, and I see that binomial being cubed, I think I can expand and simplify. Okay, so this is my thought bubble. I'm thinking, let's expand and simplify this thing. Instead of, I guess it's more of like a thought bubble, I'm looking at that thinking, I can do some algebraic work through expansion and see how that simplifies. And that's what I'm going to do. So I first check that. First, I try that direct substitution. Just try it. You got to plug it in. Sometimes that's going to work. Sometimes that's going to be the end of our limit calculation. We're going to be able to plug it in. If this wasn't h equals 0, if this was h equals 1, pop that thing in there and you're done. You're going to have a numeric value for your limit. You're going to know what the limit is. That's not the case here. So let's keep this going. So let's rewrite limit 5 plus h cubed minus 125 over h as h goes to 0. And let's keep this going. Now, I have not calculated the limit. I'm going to do some algebra as I go. So I wanted to start with it as it came to us and show you proper notation. So we're going to use an equal sign. We are not calculating the limit yet. That limit notation carries with me until I actually compute the limit. Right now, I'm just doing algebra, so I got to carry that limit notation throughout. So I'm going to go ahead and expand that 5 plus h cubed. You may expand it any way you want. I am going to use Pascal's triangle and the binomial theorem here just to expand that quickly. And if you need more help on that, reference the binomial theorem, but I am going to go ahead, binomial theorem or Pascal's triangle. It's a nice way to expand binomials, anything above a square. It gives us nice little patterns, and we can expand these really quickly if we know that, if you have that memorized. If you don't, it's worth checking out. So expanding that out with the Pascal's triangle, and I'm just going to go ahead and write it in here, and then we can talk about it as we go. We're going to get 125, 5 cubed, plus a coefficient of 3 times 5 squared, which is 25, times h, plus another coefficient of 3 times 5 times h squared plus h cubed. And then we carry down the minus 125 from up above. And then all of that is going to be over h. So that's coming from, there's actually technically a coefficient of 1 on the 125. So there's a coefficient 1, 3, 3, 1 in that Pascal triangle expansion. So if that's not familiar to you and you would prefer to simply take your 5 plus h cubed and just, you know, expand that out, 5 plus h times 5 plus h times 5 plus h, and take your 5 plus h and get your 25 plus 2 plus 2 times 5, which is 10, h plus h squared, and then continue to distribute and collect like terms, you'll get to the same result. So you do this however you want to. I just am using Pascal's triangle and the binomial theorem to do that quickly. Okay, so continuing here to simplify, we're going to get the limit as h goes to 0. Notice that I'm continuing to carry my limit notation. I am only simplifying the expression right now. I am not actually taking a limit. Therefore, my limit notation needs to carry, especially since I'm using the equality here, saying that these are equal and I haven't taken a limit yet. So I must keep it, and I will continue to remind you guys of that throughout the video. So 125 plus 75h plus 15h squared plus h cubed minus 125, all divided by h. All right, look at that. We've got some cancellation, 125 and minus 125. And as I continue here, I also notice that in the terms that are left, there is a common factor of h. So a couple things, I could divide each term by h, or I could factor it out. I'm gonna go ahead and show the factoring out. Factor it out, 75 plus 15h plus h squared divided by h. And then the h's will cancel, which we'd get to the same result if we had divided each term by h. And we'll keep going again with the limit notation. I have not taken a limit. I'm just doing algebra at this point on the expression that we're looking at. So then we've got 75 plus 15h plus h squared. And now, even though at the beginning I had that 0 over 0 where I needed to do some more work, I needed to figure out what that was, I needed to simplify, look for some way to simplify that so I could calculate the limit, I am now able to calculate the limit. And what I can do now is I can actually plug in 0, so I'm actually taking the limit right now. Now I'm actually applying the limit, take the limit, carried the notation down as I simplified, but now I'm actually going to take the limit. So the limit notation will drop. I will get 75. I can use direct substitution now that I've simplified. And my result ends up being 75. And there is the answer for that first example, if we could get it all on the screen there. Okay. So again, the idea, right, we started off and we came to a place where we knew we needed to do a little more work so that we could simplify. And so then I look at what is the expression, what is the equation, what sort of algebra could I use to simplify it? And in this case, I expanded and simplified. Okay. So let's look at another example. So here comes another example. We're taking the limit of the root of x plus 9 minus 3 over x as x goes to 0. So again, when we're working limits, the first thing we're going to try is we're going to try and just see, and I'm putting this in red, like this is my thought. Maybe you just do this in your head, but we got to have a path. We got to know which tools to apply. And in order to figure out which tools to apply, the first thing we should do is try direct substitution. And if I plug in x equals 0 right here, notice what happens. The square root of 9 minus 3 over 0. We can already see that division by 0 is going to be an issue. but we're not quite sure yet if it means we're going to have infinite behavior or something that we could simplify algebraically and possibly have a common root in the numerator and denominator. So notice when I take the square root of 9, I get 3 minus 3, 0 over 0. So 0 over 0 means we need to, and I always kind of just boom, boom, boom. This is definitely something that we should flag. It creates some interesting behavior. It tells us, let's do more work, right? We got to go in and we got to figure out what's happening here because this is something interesting mathematically, this 0 over 0. So we have to do more work. I see the roots. And so as soon as I see the roots, my little thought bubble on the roots is that I could think about using conjugates. So I'm going to think about using some conjugates here in order to simplify this root. So that's the algebraic technique that I think about. So these are all the things that I do when I first glance at a limit. Like when I'm coming across a limit, which tools from my toolbox should I pull out, right? I try a direct substitution. That gives me a clue as to what to do next. The 0 over 0 tells me there's probably some algebraic simplification here that I could work with. So then I come back to the limit. I say, well, what kind of a limit? What kind of a function am I working with? What kind of an expression am I working with? And since this has a root in it, I think let's try working a conjugate. And so we come in here and we say, well, what would be the conjugate of that numerator that would reduce that root and see what we could get? And that's going to be x plus 9 plus 3 over the square root of x plus 9 plus 3. Now, what's very nice about working with a conjugate is when I multiply this all the way out, when I multiply out these two expressions in the numerator, the middle two terms, I'm going to have a positive 3 root x plus 9 and a negative 3 root x plus 9. I'm not even going to write them down because they cancel. Okay? Again, I am doing only the algebra, therefore I need the limit notation to carry throughout. When I multiply the square root of x plus 9 times the square root of x plus 9, what I'm left with is simply x plus 9. The two middle terms cancel out, and then I have negative 3 times positive 3, which leaves me with a negative 9. In the denominator, I have this entire expression, and I'm going to just leave it in the product, x times the square root of x plus 9 plus 3. Now notice in the numerator, since all that canceling happened, these 9s now can't continue to simplify and cancel. I have not taken a limit yet, so the limit notation carries. Limit as x approaches 0, we cannot lose that. I have not simplified the limit yet. I haven't actually done the limit. I'm just simplifying the expression I'm taking the limit of. And then I've got x over, in the denominator I have x times the square root of x plus 9 plus 3. And now the x's cancel, leaving me with 1 in the numerator. And I continue, and I've got the limit as x approaches 0 of 1 over the square root of x plus 9 plus 3. And I've done my simplification. And so now I have an equivalent expression, except for at x equals 0, an equivalent function to the original function I was taking the limit of, except at x equals 0. But when x goes to 0, I am actually able to use direct substitution. So let's do it. So let's now use direct substitution. So let's get in here and let's use direct substitution. When I do direct substitution, this becomes 1 over the square root of, we're plugging in 0 for x, so this becomes the square root of 9, plus 3. So we get 1 over 3 plus 3. And my answer here is 1/6. And I have calculated my answer using algebraic techniques to compute this limit. So I've calculated my answer for both of these. So here's the root one where we use the conjugate.